got somebody next to you, just take their hand, we'll say it this morning, we're going to offer you some prayers and serve the community this morning. Amen. How many of you know that rain just adds a little extra drowsiness and makes your bed feel so much better? Lord have mercy. But we're supposed to get above 60 degrees. I think we can declare that winter is officially over, but I say that skeptically. Because 2 years ago, I checked the records. We had the council church in April because of snow. Amen. So we're going to pray that the Lord move the ice and snow away forever, ever, forever, ever. That's right. Ever, ever. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for just being who you are and that we get to come to this place. We thank you that we get to worship you freely and openly. God, you are good. You've kept us through another week.
Yeah.
We've faced many things. We've seen many things happen. We've watched life for some end and for others begin. And yet, for some of us, we're just in the middle trying to figure out what's next. God, would you grant us your wisdom and your knowledge about where to go, what to do, and how to do? And would you enlighten our hearts, Lord, that it may be open to what you're saying to us. Speak to us individually and corporately. Then more for the person whose hand I'm holding. You know their life story. Would you give them strength? Would you give them encouragement? Would you remind them of the hope that we have in you? It's not a fictitious hope, but rather it's affirmation that all your promises are true and will come to pass. And may we walk and stand on that today. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. If you will remain standing, if you have
your communion cup and the wafer, if you will join in with us this morning.
Normally, when we're serving communion, it's from the standpoint to talk about it. What has been called the Last Supper in the Gospels. But I want to call our attention this morning to Paul's writing in Corinthians. Paul reminded the Corinthian church, the church that I love in the New Testament. I love it because it had issues, it had broken people, it had people who had challenges, people who was mischief, people who had a little dirt on them. My kind of church, because I think it resembles more who we are versus who we want to pretend to be. But Paul wrote to this church and he spoke to them and said, listen, make sure when you're taking communion that you're thinking about taking care of your brothers and sisters who may be less fortunate. Check your heart. Examine your heart and make sure that you have a concern and a passion and are doing something for them. Lest you partake of this and said, some sleep. Because their only concern was about themselves. So this morning, as we prepare to take communion, let us be mindful, not only of the privilege of being able to do this, but for those who are on the margins and need us to stand in the gap for them.
Yes.
So this bread we take this morning, it represents Christ's body, which was broken for us, because when we were on the margins, he had already covered us. And he passed it to his disciples, and he said, take, eat, eat all of this. And they did eat. Let us eat together. And then after giving thanks, he passed the cup and told them, this cup represents my blood, which will be shed for many for the remission of sins. Don't you know there's power in the blood of Jesus? Because it cleanses us. It gave us right relationship with a God that our sins has separated us from. And so as we drink up this cup today, let us drink being reminded of the precious blood and all that is done for us. And they all did drink together. Let us drink. Now, I want you to take a moment, find a couple of people that you did not come here with this morning and greet them. Tell them good morning. Glad to see you. Yeah.
I got a little something going on, so I'm going to find somebody. Forgive me.
That's not nice.
perfect.
All right, praise the Lord, everybody. How many of you are grateful to be here? Another day, another chance. Hallelujah. God is worthy and He's faithful. And we appreciate Him on today. We ask that everyone stand to your feet one more time. We're going to celebrate God. This song says, Lord, you're worthy. And we give you the praise. Hallelujah. That's all right. Let's clap our hands. Come on, come on. It's all right to have a little fun and laugh sometimes in Jesus' name. Amen. Here we go.
Lord, you're worthy. Lord, you're worthy. And we give you. And we give you the praise. Lord, you're worthy. Lord, you're worthy. And we give you. And we give you the praise.
Lord, you're worthy.
And we give you,
and we give you the praise.
Lord, you're worthy.
Lord, you're worthy.
And we give you,
and we give you the praise.
He's always making a way.
Always making a way.
And we give you,
and we give you the praise.
Lord, you're worthy.
Yeah. Lord, you're worthy.
And we give you,
and we give
oh,
you the praise.
Oh, Lord, you're awesome. Yeah.
Lord, you're awesome.
And we give you the praise.
And we give you the praise.
Lord, you're awesome. And we give you,
and we give you the praise.
You're always making a way,
always making a way.
And we give you,
and we give you the praise.
Lord, you're awesome, yeah.
Lord, you're awesome.
And we give you,
and we
now
give
everybody
you
clap your hands. Come on, come on. Let's make some noise in this place. Everybody clap your hands. Yeah. We're gonna take it up. Lord, you're holy.
Lord, you're holy.
And we give you.
And we give you the praise.
Lord, you're holy.
Lord, you're holy.
There's nobody like you. And we give you.
And we give you the praise.
Always making a way.
Always making a way.
We give you.
And we give you the praise.
Lord, you're holy.
Lord, you're holy.
And we give you.
And we give you the praise.
Oh, Lord, you're faithful. Yes, you are.
Lord, you're faithful.
And we give you.
And we give you the praise.
And we give you,
and we give you the praise.
Always making a way,
always
yes,
making a way.
And we give you,
and we give you the praise.
Lord, you're faithful, yeah.
Lord, you're faithful.
And we give you,
and we give you the praise.
Everybody clap your hands. Come on, let's make some noise in this place. Hey, everybody clap your hands. Has he been good to anybody else? Hey, oh Lord, you're mighty, yeah.
Mighty.
And we give you,
and we give you the praise.
Lord, you're mighty,
Lord, you're mighty.
And we give you all
and
the praise.
We give you the praise.
You're always making a way,
always making a way.
And we give you,
and we give you the praise.
Lord, you're mighty, yeah.
Lord, you're mighty.
And we give you,
and we give you the praise.
Lord, for all that, yes,
Lord,
you are.
Lord,
we
Sometimes religious people develop rituals because that was what makes us feel comfortable. And so Paul was debunking those myths. So I'm going to let you keep your seat this morning. I'm going to read something that we've already read once before, but I just want to put it back in your hearing as we talk about this ideal, this theme of letting him lead, meaning the Lord. How many of you know you have a real hard time with following? You'd rather leave. And that's not necessarily a bad thing, but it can become a challenging thing when it's God saying, let me lead. So here's what the word of God says, starting in verse 22. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. Now those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with his passions and desires. Verse 25, if we live by the Spirit, let us also walk by the Spirit. I'm going to struggle with this story. I was watching a movie, and the couple was trying to learn how to dance. They were trying to learn how to tango, and the thing that was most interesting, when you're learning this dance, apparently, one person has to lead while the other one follows. Now, me, I already got two left shoes, so it's not probable that I'm going to ever learn it, but it was interesting to watch, because what kept happening was they kept smashing into each other. And the instructor finally got fed up and said, one of you has got to yield and let the other one take lead. And so they began to have this discourse between each other about who was going to lead and why one was more qualified than the other. And after going through this discourse together, they didn't even realize that the instructor had walked out the room. Because the instructor, I guess, had said, enough is enough. If y'all can't figure out which one of y'all is going to lead, then I'm not going to continue to spend my time to show you a dance that will never happen because you keep running into each other. And I would suggest to all of us this morning, myself included, I'm not exempt, that there are times in life where the Lord is trying to lead us and we keep clashing with him and running into him because there are things that he wants to do, even in the midst of sorrow and challenges and issues of life, if we would just let him lead. Paul brings up this fruit of the Spirit here. He's talking about ways that God has called us to live, that we cannot live apart from the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is not an it. It's not something that you just catch. How many of you grew up in church and you heard them say stuff like, ooh, they caught the Holy Ghost? And me being who I was, I always got in trouble because I wanted to know, how did you catch him? And if you could catch him, how could he get free again? Because it seemed like every Sunday we was catching him again. As you can see, I didn't survive well in Sunday school 101. But the reality of it is, we cannot live out these traits or characteristics without God's Spirit, those of us who are believers. And it's in his Spirit and in his guidance that he gives us, watch this, self-control. How many of you have ever said, or better yet, I ain't going to put you on Front Street like that on this fourth Sunday. How many of you have heard somebody say stuff like, the devil made me do it? Can I suggest to you that the enemy, Satan, our adversary, can never make you? Young people, pick this up early so you don't pick up some of us old folks' bad traits. Catch this, please. Let it soak in your soul. The enemy cannot make you do anything because God gives us free will. That is the amazing thing which makes this text interesting, is the fact that while there is divine sovereignty, there is human responsibility. And through God's Spirit dwelling in us as believers, he has given us the ability, watch this, to live a life under control. What does this word mean, self-control? Here it means one's ability to contain and abstain from certain passions, affections, and desires. It's the ability, watch this, to actually allow the Spirit of God, along with our intentional focus and effort, to cause us to live out the rest of the fruit of the Spirit. I don't think it's accidental or coincidental that self-control is on the end. It starts off with love, because love is what anchors it all. But then he goes on, joy, peace, patience, goodness, kindness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law, meaning you cannot legislate these things. You have the freedom of these things, you and I do, but there's something about this word self-control. Because if we're honest this morning, let's be real, let's begin to do the spiritual digging, we real good at trying to control other people.
Say it.
But how well do we do with controlling ourselves?
Say it, honey.
Self-control is a word that's deep because it requires us to dig deep into self. Meaning, if it's about affections, desires, and passions, here's the first question I got for you. Take some time, think about this. If you're a note taker, write it down. But I want you to think about this. What are some of your affections, desires, and passions? are some things that you like. Watch this. Here's what will really trip you up. It ain't necessarily sinful unless you get too much of it. Well, I know it was just Saturday, but now it's Sunday. So I'm going to ask you that again. What are some things that are your passion and or desires that they're not sinful, but if you just get too much of them, you lose control? If this was just adults in the room, there would be a certain thing that I would say, because there are times where we lose control because certain things that we intend to swallow as a beverage that feels more good to us causes us to loosen up in such a way that sometimes we begin to say things that we wouldn't normally say. And so the old adage goes that if you can get enough of a certain beverage in a certain kind of individual, you can learn whatever you want to, because somehow we lose control. But I would suggest for some of us, we don't need a beverage. Sometimes it's the right person, the right situation, hit the right nerve, and we lose control. So what Paul is saying here, first of all, if we're going to have self-control, watch this, there has to be resistance. In other words, discipline. We have to be willing to be restrained. We have to be willing to live within the guardrails and the guardrails of what God says. So that means stuff like when God says, turn the other cheek when someone is coming for us, we have to be willing to live by that. When God is calling us to have peace in the midst of chaos, when we want to flee the situation, he's telling us to stay right there. That means in order to have self-control, we got to stay right where God wants us to be. That means that there are times where God will put us, watch this, in the middle of what I call development situations, just to teach us self-control. You want to learn self-control with God? I found that he puts you in the most uncontrollable circumstances so that you're forced to lean on him, so that then by his spirit you can have self-control. Now, I know for some of y'all I'm hitting the nerve because you got to go to work tomorrow and you're going to say, Pastor, you don't understand my work environment. You don't know who I sit next to. You don't know who I got to deal with. I'm going to a family function. Pastor, you don't know who is going to be there. I got one cousin that always wants something, ain't never got nothing, and therefore I sometimes lose control. What are your pet peeves? Because it's in our pet peeves and the things that we allow to get under our skin where we often lose control. I will give you one of mine. Lazy people is one of mine. When I see somebody lazy, especially if it's somebody's grown child living in their mama house with no desire to do anything but stay at mama house, I just want to pick them up and sit them outside and say to their parents, you cannot go get them. Leave them there. Let them figure it out. But there's something about this text that I promise you, it's gonna bother you. It's something about this that says God is not concerned about other people per se. He's concerned about us having control of us. There has to be a resistance of the flesh. What does that mean? That means when our body wants to do something, we have to tell it no. Yeah, like when you diet and everything else that you're supposed to not eat looks so good.
Lord.
Or when I see young brothers, when I do make it to the gym, running circles around me, lifting five times as me, and I go, wow, I might as well just put my sweats on and go back home. I'm just going to lift this donut today, amen. But he's called us to resist what our flesh wants to do. Why? Because our flesh wants to do everything that the Spirit of God does not want us to do. So there's this constant war, but he says the war is winnable. In fact, it's not more only winnable, we have conquered it already if we lean into allowing the Spirit of God to lead us. We have to resist flesh, but we also have to resist temptation. Temptation is not bad unless you give into it. Life is full of temptation. Yeah. Don't tell me it's not. If somebody riding down the street dropped a bag of money and ain't nobody looking, and you start adding up the bills you got, and you just on the other side of the church cameras where it can't be picked up. Some of y'all in here would say, that must be a sign.
That's right. From the Lord.
That Jesus done came through. Might have the nerve to tithe on But temptation is a part of life, but yet God's Spirit gives us the ability to resist it. Which means when we are tempted by measures beyond our control, the Bible says that the Lord gives us a way of escape, which means two things. One, there's always another option in the midst of it. Two, there's certain temptations he don't even allow to come to us because he knows we can't escape it. So here it is, when we are controlled by God's Spirit, we have the ability, watch this, to resist what our flesh wants and to resist what looks good to the eyes, to the hands, to the feet. Paul is speaking to these Galatians because they have been living in bondage and he's trying to teach them how to be free. He says you have to have the ability to restrain, resist. But not only that, he says we have to have the ability to renounce, meaning death. That means some stuff, he says, has to die. Some ways have to die. Some of us, if we're honest, and I believe probably if I was going on a limb and say all of us, have certain patterns and purposes, rather plans, that we live out, that we grew up with. Don't mean they necessarily healthy, but we grew up with them. Certain ways we handle conflict, somebody talk to me, that we grew up learning, don't mean it's necessarily healthy. Certain ways of doing things, not illegal, but not necessarily healthy. He says in verse 24, now those of us who belong to Christ Jesus, watch this, have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Has, past tense, meaning he's pointing back to when Jesus died on the cross for you and me. That in a sense, it began the death of our flesh. That means Jesus kicked it off when he died on the cross for us. But then there's still a work that you and I have to do, that some stuff just got to die. Somebody talk to me. You know, you got an attitude that need to die. The way Amen. You respond to people. Amen. People don't like talking to you because your temper always on 100.
Amen.
They won't bring certain stuff to you because they already know how you going to react. Or some stuff is just, well, you know, you can't treat your old dog new tricks. You're not a dog. And if God's Spirit lives in you, we all have become a new creation. Behold, the new has come. And so that means some stuff has to die. Here's what I want to ask you. Here's what I want you to ponder. Think about this. And seriously, what in you you know needs to go? What are you still allowing to live? Is it animosity towards someone, someplace, something? Is it anger over a situation? Is it bitterness? But he says the flesh has been crucified. That means, watch this, here's what makes life hard, because God sometimes allows us to go some things that are hurtful, that are painful, but yet he's saying you can't respond like you normally would. You've got to die, and watch this, be loving, kind, gentle, faithful, joyful, patient. Watch this, all of that while the reality still ain't changing. Can I tell you what makes dying to self so hard? Is because we want, if I feel like this, if I got to die, some of me, some of you need to die too. We gonna die together. But what God is saying, it may not never die in your neighbor, it may not never die in your family member, it may not never die in your parent, it may always be what it is, but I called you to lay down your life, kill your emotions being out of control, kill your anger being out of control, kill your bitterness being out of control, kill your mind and thoughts running rampant being out of control, and just live how I called you to live. Somebody talk to me, because I know that sounds real good, but when the rubber meets the road, when somebody's accusing you or something you know is not true and you want to put them on blast, but God says, nope, you're dead to self. You're going to keep living and watch me fight your battles. The Bible says, vengeance is mine. I shall repay, says the Lord. Don't get in the way of me doing what I am, because I am who I am, because I am the great I am. But yet, when flesh is still living, and all of us got something fleshly that's still alive, something in you wants to say, nah, hold up, that's my name. Something in us wants to say, nah, you ain't gonna get that off. But Paul says here that something about us, because of our union with Jesus, our union with Christ, when he died, we died. When he got up, we got up. When he sat in the heavenly places, we get the privilege of heavenly access. And because we are kingdom citizens, there are things about us that, watch this, when we want to do them, we can't, because God says that's out of bounds. Some stuff. Gotta die. Man I love, grew up with. He could go from 0 to 100 in a blink. And it typically didn't take much. And he had long hair, and it was classic. When he was upset, his hair would stand up. He hot. And so one day, someone called him about an issue that was a pet peeve of his. And 2 minutes into the conversation, he went from 0 to 100. And his voice was loud. It was shaking the house. He was mad. Person on the other end of the phone was trying to tell him, don't go to that level. It's not that serious. You're going to have a heart attack or a stroke. And I don't think he heard any of it. Here's the amazing thing that happened. Some of you young people don't know what this is, but our house had an answering machine. And the answering machine had an actual tape. I know y'all might not know what that is either. Wasn't no MP3s, wasn't no CDs. It had a tape. And when the answering machine would come on, you would know it because the tape would click real loud. And the problem was, on this day, the answering machine went coom, but this person was on 100 and they couldn't hear it go coom. So all of their response was recorded. So later on that evening, we were talking about the situation that was happening, and this person called him back trying to say, you shouldn't have went to that level. And when the person called back, this person was in tears because they had a chance to listen to the tape and hear how they went to 100 over something that should have been a 5. They had lost control. And now they was... we're tasked with trying to repair losing control. Why do I say that to you? Because here's the deal. When something is still alive in us, all of us are capable of losing control. Who have you hurt when you lost control? The Bible says you can murder somebody with your tongue. Who have you slain? Look at me. Don't look down. Don't grab your phone now. Look this way. Who have you verbally assaulted? Because some was still alive and they touched that nerve. Can I tell you when you know when it's hit? When people are trying to talk rational to you, you can't even hear it. Because you're going to get your point across. You're going to make sure they learn today never to come across that bridge again, because you're going to burn it down. But Paul is saying, if we've been with Christ and we are in union with him, those things have died intentionally. So here's the question. What do you need to be intentional about? What do I need to be intentional about dying? What's still alive? What still will wake you up out of the middle of the night and set you off? Because here's the deal. Here's what our enemy loves. Whatever we feed grows. So if we feed anger, it grows. If we feed bitterness, it grows. So whatever we feed our flesh and allow to continue to grow, watch this, it ain't gonna never die, it's just gonna keep growing. So I'm gonna ask you again, and here's what we gonna do, because you got some folk around you who are struggling with the same thing that you are. We gonna take a couple minutes, that's right. I want you to turn to whoever's on your road. I'm gonna give you a few minutes. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to talk about what's still alive in you that needs to die. Go ahead. If you ain't got somebody next to you, find somebody. Don't use that excuse. Well, it ain't time for it to die. I ain't got nobody next to me. Go watch this. Call somebody. Text somebody. Talk to somebody. Because the very same thing that dies in me. God wants you. God wants you. In you. Reach out. God has a plan. 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 Don't be cute and superficial. What in you know you can die? Just keep talking to me. We got young people in this room, they need to know so we can help them live. Come on, you got a couple more minutes. Be honest with yourself. What still living? That all you need is the right breeze to come through, and it sends you to a place. Churchy thing. Oh, I'm good. I'm cool. I'm blessed and highly favored. You know, I got a few trials and obstacles in my way, but the Lord is providing. He making a way out of no way. And then when you leave here, the first person who cuts you off getting on the street, you letting them have it. Did I just hit somebody's nerve?
Yeah.
Can I tell you why this is so critical, why this is so important to me as a pastor? It's because it's in those moments where you and I lose control that the most dangerous things happens in terms of not only our soul, but our witness to other people. Because they're looking for us either two ways when we say we are in Christ and that we are Christians. Either A, they're looking to see that we can give a better representation of how to handle trouble.
Yes.
Or B, they expecting us to act just like them so they can use that as an excuse to say, this is why I don't go to church, because church people just like me. Can I tell you? Both are right, but here's the difference. The church is the hospital. This is where you get well. This is where you allow God in. So if you ever going to experience self-control, that means some stuff got to die, which means you got to be honest. You can do this when you get home later about what is your passion and your desire. You know, that stuff you wish Jesus didn't know, but he know it anyway. Because here's the safety net. Let me read something to you from this book. Emotionally Healthy Church. It says this, Peter Scazzaro says this, a revelation of God's free grace gives us the courage to face the painful truth about ourselves. As we step out into the tightrope of discovering the unpleasant things about ourselves, we have a safety net below the gospel of Jesus Christ. Can I tell you that ain't an ugliness in us that Jesus don't already know, that his blood didn't already cure and take care of? Can I tell you that isn't a brokenness in us that Jesus cannot handle? So it's okay if you're going to be honest with anybody. Be honest with yourself. Stop telling yourself you are right when you ain't all right. Stop telling yourself you got it together when you ain't got it together. Stop telling yourself you well when you ain't well. I know you ain't well. Let the right person come at the right time with the wrong thing. You gonna show me how hurt you really are. But he says, we've got Jesus holding us underneath, which means it's okay to come apart and to be vulnerable and be broken. Satan wants us to live fictitiously because then we can never experience the true victory of what it means to be saved. We'll never know what it's like for him to be a healer until we admit that we're broken. We'll never know what it's like for him to fix sickness until we tell him we're not well. We'll never know what it's like to gain strength if we never tell him we're tired. But can I tell you, here's what Paul was saying to this church. There's a freedom in Jesus that allows us to be all of that, and he watched this. Like Jeremiah said about the potter and the potter's wheel has us in his hands, and he's still taking clay and molding and shaping. So you ain't got a life where I am today. Just know if you stick around long enough, Jesus is growing me up to be everything he wants me to be, and he wants you to be. So what's still alive? What's still working you in a way that holds up your progress? What is it that you cover up, hoping nobody else sees? Because here's what I know. Most of us grew up under this act, if we're honest. What goes on in this house? See how y'all can finish that? Can I tell you, there's some truth to that, because there are good boundaries, but can I tell you where it's killed us? When we lose in control and hurt about things, and we'll never allow God's spirit to work, it holds us. So Paul says, it's been crucified. So then he says, if it's been crucified, if we live by the spirit, verse 25, let us also walk by the Spirit. That means that word walk is present tense. It's a continuous thing, meaning growth with the Lord is continuous. Sanctification is initial. When we're saved, he sets us apart. But it's also continual because he's growing us day by day. He says, if we live by, meaning if God's word is going to be the guide, then walk by it. If we're going to go through the pain of allowing God to work, then we might as well walk by it. If we're going to live by it, we got to walk by it. That means that there ought to be some growth. You've heard me say this before. I've gotten over a long time ago. People were telling me how long you've been in church. That's good. But tell me how long you know Jesus. Because you can be in church 50 years and still not know Jesus.
Say it.
And your attitude can still be as nasty.
Yes.
Your demeanor can be just as turn-offish as it was the day he came through the doors. It's not enough to have a church membership. It's about who Jesus is in our lives. So he says, if we're going to live this, we got to walk this. In other words, there's a reliance that comes, a total dependency. How many of you know you don't like being totally dependent on nobody?
Amen.
Does that anybody besides me that a total dependency makes you frightened a little bit? But Jesus says if we're going to be who we are called to be, there has to be a total reliance on him. We do our part, but yet we understand doing our part totally dependent on him to give us strength. Most of us are worker bees, though. We want to work it out, figure it out, solve it out, do it on our own. And there are certain things like living out the fruit of the Spirit we can't do on our own. Listen to me, young people, if you're in here, don't make the mistake we made. We just try to work our way through everything. Broken, damaged, hurting, working. And saying we're doing it all in the name of the Lord. We're going to keep it moving. And we got all kind of Christian slogans to help us go. I'm a soldier in arms. The Lord has called me on the battlefield, and I'm just fighting for the Lord. I ain't going to let nothing get me down. And Satan laughs at us because you're already broken. I don't have to get somebody down that's broke already. But self-control says I'm gonna be intentional about what my part is, but I'm gonna totally trust the Lord to handle it. It's like that exercise, team building exercise, where one person stands and the other one's supposed to be able to fall back on you. You're supposed to catch them, and the person falling ain't supposed to worry. But how many of you know if you do that exercise, you show enough words.
You're right.
You sizing up the person. How strong are they? I don't want somebody smaller than me being the one that catch me. How you feeling today? Let me check your arms. What's your stats? Let me check your pulse. But God is saying, you can fall back totally on me. I'm totally reliable. I'm totally dependent. There's someone that you can depend on. I'm the one who can help you. Watch this, master what you're trying to master without me. I can help you live this. Let me read something in your ears. 1 Corinthians, don't go there, but I just want to read this to you. This is the intentionality, though. This is our part. Verse 24, chapter 9 of 1 Corinthians, Paul says this, and I'm out of your way. Do you not know those who run in a race all run, but only one receives the prize? Run in such a way that you may win. Here is the verse 25. Everyone who competes in the games exercises self control, exercises self-control. Everyone who competes in the games exercises self-control in all things. Not some things, but all things. Therefore, I run in such a way as not without aim. I box in such a way as not beating the air, but I discipline my body and make it my slave. What Paul is saying here is I'm intentional. That means when I want to do something that I shouldn't, I intentionally fight myself. I intentionally go against what my flesh wants to do. He says, I exercise this. I exercise self-control. That word exercise, you know what it means? It means you got to do something. Now, let's be real. How many of us to the point have ever wrestle with yourself to keep yourself from doing something that self didn't need to do? Ain't no war like the one wrestling with yourself. When opportunity exists right in front of you, I can do this, I can do it right now, I can do it the way I want to, especially if it's revenge. Somebody talk to me. Yeah, I can get this off right now when you ain't looking, when you thought I forgot, when you thought it was over. Yeah, I let a whole year go by. I've been plotting, scheming, waiting, and now God just gave me an opportunity. It's in those moments that Paul is saying, Because what he's talking about to this Corinthian church is this Isthmian Games. It was second to only the Olympics. They happen every other year, and only one person got a reward. So every person trained tremendously to win, because only one person got a crown. They went after it with everything they had. And so Paul is saying to us, sometimes you got to go after yourself with everything to keep yourself from doing what self wants to do. Now, how many of you know you already, you tell now, because as soon as this text says exercise, you're like, that's a no-go. Be real. How many of you started an exercise plan in January? How many of you just said, I done gave up. I'm just going to get it when I can. I ain't even trying to do no more resolutions about exercise. Goals, gym, Planet Fitness. Nobody else is getting my money. But the text says it, and it says it because, watch this, it's hard to be intentional with ourselves. I can be intentional with you all day long. I can diagnose you. I can fix you. I'm the only one who got that gift in this room, huh? I can sit you down. I can get you straight. Me and Jesus gonna fix you. Don't ask me about fixing me. But it's that intentionality that he's after. Why am I drilling this? Why am I hammering this? Why am I going so hard for this? Because it's in the moments of losing control that Satan gets victory. It's in those moments. All of us have a time where we wish we could get it back and do it different. It's in those moments. But if we lean on God's Spirit living on the inside of us, those are us who are His. He can guide us and help us with control. He can minimize and even alleviate urges. Yeah. Because sometimes it ain't a temptation, it's an urge. Somebody talk to me. It's like a pulse. And every now and then it thumps a little louder than other times. Yeah, just look at me. Don't look at your neighbor. I don't want them to know. And it's sitting there laying dormant. But it's a lion waiting to roar. It's in those moments that Jesus wants us to lean on the Holy Spirit to control what we get ready to do. Have you ever seen somebody talking to themselves and you go, what is wrong with them? Sometimes it's a person trying to talk themselves out of doing something that God didn't want them to do. Trust me, you stay around me long enough, you're going to catch me talking to myself. Because my palms get itchy and my fingers begin to sweat because I know y'all don't pray for me. But there's something about it that God understands. Here's the magnificent thing, and we're going to pray. And our music ministry is going to come back. Here's the most magnificent thing. There isn't an urge, a pulse, an issue, a pet peeve, a challenge that scares Jesus off. Rather, he's saying, I've given you my Spirit to help you handle it all. All things. Not some things. Not the thing you keep in your back pocket saying, I'm going to take care of this. I'll give Jesus that. And I even give him this. But this over here, I'm going to handle that. No. He's saying, I've got enough because of my Spirit living in you to help you control all things. You've got somebody next to you. Take their hand. really wanted to get to the nitty gritty. All I gotta do is ask the person you live with what your control factor is like. Especially kids. If I took them in a separate room, they would sing on y'all like. Had y'all in the car going, why did you tell the pastor? With your teeth gritting up. You already getting ready to lose control. You 5 minutes outside of church. But I'm going to spare them and you today. But here's what I am going to ask. That sometime this week, if it ain't but 5 minutes, that you take a piece of paper and you sit by yourself and you jot down what are your passions and desires and write down where you need help with control. Because some of us in this sanctuary right now, if we don't allow Jesus to control it, it's not going to be good. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. We honor you for who you are, for giving us the ability to resist, to renounce, and then to rely totally on you. God, all of us come with issues. All of us come with problems. All of us come with challenges. All of us come with a system and a way of doing things, Lord, that needs work. God, we put it before you. Lord, help us to keep us under control. Lord, work on our tempers and our words and our speech and our mouths and our ears and our minds and our bodies, that all may be under subjection to you. God, if we don't, we understand that it's costly if we lose control. Lord, help my neighbor whose hand is in my hand, who life is hitting them, and they need the guidance of the Holy Spirit to help them live a controlled life. Lord, you've told us through Scripture, in essence, the key to this controlled life is surrendering more of ourselves to allow you to control more of us. So may we surrender today and then allow you to empower us to do what may go against what feels natural to us to do. And may we trust you totally and watch you continue to grow us up, that we may be more fruitful in how we live. We pray this, Lord. We ask this in Jesus' name. Let us all say together, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Can we put our hands together? I'm
going
to ask you to stand as I move the ministry this week to come back. Hard to be thankful for moments where you just feel like, you ever felt like losing control should have been justified? Or is it just me? You ever had something happen, you go, I should have had the right. And it's in those moments when we allow God to control us that we can give him thanks. Because we can step out of ourselves and know that it's the Lord at work. So as they get ready to sing this, oh, give thanks. Let's give thanks for him controlling and ordering our steps. Amen. Let's put our hands together for them.
Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. His love is good. He's a provider. He's a keeper. He is the one who sustained us. Come on, somebody. He's the one who keeps you. He makes everything all right. He keeps your family safe. He keeps protecting you in spite of you. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? He's that type of God. So the song just says, oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. For he is good. Come on, clap your hands. Let's do this one time and we're gonna get on out of here.
Oh, give thanks unto the Lord.
to the Lord, for He is good. Yes, He is good.
Oh, give thanks.
Oh, give thanks.
Come on, you know it.
To the Lord, for He is good.
Yes, He is.
Yes, He is good.
Oh, give thanks.
Oh, give thanks.
Yes.
Unto the Lord, for He is good.
Yes, He is.
Yes, He is good. For He is worthy.
Oh, give thanks
unto the Lord, for He is good.
Yes, He is.
Yes, He is good.
Oh, give thanks
unto the Lord, for He is good.
Yes, He is.
Yes, He is good.
For
He is worthy.
Yeah.
Worthy.
Yeah.
For He is good.
Yeah.
Yes, He is good.
For
He is
on your way out. God bless you. See you next week.
Amen.